Welcome to another edition of Pittsburgh Sports Line. Thanks for watching the show. I want to give a shout out right away to my neighbor who is being pulled down the street by three dogs. Glenn, have a nice night. Thanks for watching the show and spreading a good word. He said he enjoys you guys on the show also. And a few of the other guys, Big Joe, Gary, Chief, we missed you last night. We don't know what happened there. We had a great show there. And we just appreciate everybody watching. We have Matt here helping us on the camera. Devin's in the control room running a tight ship. Dave Cable's going to edit the show from last night so we can see that on air. So I appreciate all that help. We got great guest hosts here. We got a Wally Chip for all you guys that have followed baseball and Lou Gehrig. That's in honor of Wally Pip. We got Little Z. But I'm Al Levine, the talking machine. We got Chip the Prophet Hainer. We got Zach Brenner, known as Little Z. And we got Big Mike Butera back from his birthday week.
Awesome. Well, by the way, thank you for that. I appreciate that.
Well, we appreciate you. And we have a great day in sports here, and we're going to start talking sports with what's on our mind. Big Mike, what's on your mind?
What's on my mind? I'll tell you what. I'm going to do this from memory without even reading any cue cards or anything, but I'm here to talk about Brenner Cleaning and Brenner Contracting Services, an awesome organization. They're located where, Zach? You can tell me where they're located.
In Munhall, Pennsylvania.
In Munhall, PA, and they do all kinds of general plumbing, painting, construction, cleanup, drywall, plaster, masonry, roofing, contracting, residential, commercial cleaning, window cleaning, realty, property and building management. They even get into cars, my area, but they're out of on the other side of town, so that doesn't bother me about auto detailing. And they even pick up and deliver. Auto body repair, and then if that's not good enough for you in the wintertime, they do snow and ice removal. So a shout-out for Brenner Contracting and General Services. And by the way, I'm going to give them a call tomorrow because I have a problem with a failing deck in the back of my house, and we'll see how good they are, and I'll report to you very shortly. So that wasn't even a shameless promo, man. That was for the peeps, you know what I mean?
Well, for all you people that don't realize that Big Mike's trying to get a shirt, maybe a golf shirt, a t-shirt, maybe a hat.
It's done now.
Opinions are all of our own opinions and do not reflect on the station. And if we offend anybody, I apologize.
No, we don't offend.
Big Mike, what else is on your mind?
Well, I'll tell you what, it's bittersweet what's on my mind because we're all born and bred here in the city of Pittsburgh and we're all homers when it comes to the sports teams. We want to see them do as well as we possibly can under any circumstances. And when I say bittersweet, because the Penguins are, I mean, yeah, they're up 2-1. They're playing, I think this series have played better than the previous series. Consequently, I think they're going to continue to roll, but it seems like they're going to continue to roll with Tommy VC in the net, whom I like. But I think that Marc-Andre Fleury is, I really like him. I can't stand this jazz about when you hear about a player's fragile psychic. I don't buy into that. The only way they're probably going to go back to Fleury is if Vokoun gets injured, which I certainly hope not, or if he lays, you know, if he drops a bomb or something like that, and we don't want to see that happen either. But Marc-Andre Fleury, you know, when a guy only makes the news and he's a professional athlete, and the only time he makes the news is when he's in the sports section, that's always a good thing. And I think, I don't know him. You probably know of him or better than I do, or certainly. He seems to be a solid guy. I've always liked his off the ice type of gatherings that I've seen. So I'm kind of bummed that we could go all the way and he can get lost in a shuffle. I certainly hope that doesn't mean anything bad for the end of the season. You know, and not having Marc-Andre be around for the remainder of his pro career being here in Pittsburgh. Now, with that said and done, that's not the only time that type of stuff happens. You know, you've probably been around long enough, and you may well remember Ken Dryden. You may too. Ken Dryden playing the last six games of the regular season in 71, bada bing, bada boom. He ran the table in the playoffs. Now, the guy he replaced was a five-time All-Star, Rogge Vachon. And the irony is that Vachon did it as a rookie when he replaced Gump Worsley with a... Yep, he knows it all.
The old gumster played goalie without a mask.
Yep, he sure did. But Vanshaw, who got replaced by Dryden, actually did the same, not did the same thing, but it happened to with Vanshaw replacing a
sort of like Wally Pipp and Lou Gehrig.
That's absolutely correct, and I bet you know who Wally Chip is.
Wally Pipp now.
This is Chip. That's Wally.
And Chip, you know.
Chip's here.
Yeah, and Big Z.
Smoking Jim's
hey,
not.
Smoking Jim.
Hey, shout out to Smoking Jim. Absolutely. His transmission blew up. I didn't want to have any negativity, but guy's trapped, can't get anywhere, and he was in Altoona.
He stranded on the road. Oh, he has Altoona.
Yeah, yesterday.
So well, I had a good
he's
question.
Still waiting for a ride. He heard you're traveling with cars.
I would have gladly picked him up. I had a good question for him this evening.
You're giving us a call. We could have hooked him up with some tickets to go watch the Curve play.
I thought that's where he was on assignment.
Mm-hmm.
He's a football guy.
Watching Jameson Taillon pitch.
Sorry to interrupt your thing.
No, that's
cool.
That's
late breaking news with Smoking Jim.
I wish you were here because I'll direct.
He missed yesterday. Too.
He's
on a streak again.
I will. Okay. And there you have my and again, Mark Andre, because I know you watch this show. I'm feeling for you, pal, man, because I really do care for you. And you'll be a part of the winner, but maybe you'll get a game in or two, or maybe you'll carry the team for whatever reason. But I like Mark Andre Fleury, and I do like Tommy VC, and I love the Penguins. So there you go.
Very good. All right. Now, what's on your mind, little Z?
Well, I was going to talk about the Penguins, too, so I guess I'll touch a little bit on that, too. But until Vokoun plays bad, why would you want to pull Vokoun out until he plays bad? We might as well ride the hot hand until he plays bad. And Fleury should be chomping at the bit for greatness if he does get back in there, because if anything can happen, in a matter of seconds, Vokoun could be out. He could be ran into. He could get knocked down. And now Fleury's coming back in. So we'll see what Fleury's made of. Here in the next, he should be ready to go. That's what he should, if he's the guy and he's the number one guy, he should be ready to get back in there.
And plus, they're playing better defense, not to interrupt. And that always helps, except at the end of the game. And then in overtime.
23 seconds.
Yeah, and then in overtime. But other than that, we'll revisit that. All right. Do you have something else besides Penguins, or you just want to? We can move on and we'll talk later. All right. Chip, I know you come back from D.C. and out of respect to your mom and father being reunited in Arlington Cemetery, my sympathy, prayers, and a lot of good stuff with
Thank
that.
Thank you very much. But what's on my mind tonight, first off, extreme tragedy in Oklahoma City yesterday. Two massive tornadoes tore through Moore, Oklahoma, which is a suburb of Oklahoma City, and destroyed two elementary schools, and there are quite a bit of casualties, a number of them being children. And, our thoughts and prayers go out to the families that have been affected. And I want to give a little shout out to an NBA player who really answered the call. Kevin Durant, who is the Oklahoma City Thunder's star basketball player, wrote a check for $1 million for the relief fund out of his own bank account. And I got to tell you, that's not taking a couple of dollars out of your pocket. That's pretty substantial, and I think it's something that's worth noting. But, really what's on my mind today, Alan touched on the fact that yesterday I'd, attended my mother's funeral at Arlington National Cemetery. And, going down there, it was a great honor. My mother and father both served and they're both resting in Arlington. But I just want to speak to for a moment about all of the men and the women that serve in the armed forces for the United States, whether they serve on active duty, whether they serve as reserves. These people they deserve the utmost respect. They treated myself and my family with a great deal of respect, and my folks. And you look at the precision that they do their thing in, and I can't say enough about our troops. And I just want to thank everybody in the armed services that treats retired veterans and deceased veterans with the respect that they do. And I think that's something that needs to be spoken to. And
I heard you were getting saluted too. Tell us a little bit about that, because that's quite an honor to your parents.
Well, my mother was an officer in the Navy, and she was buried with a full color guard with a full band, a funeral procession with the horse-drawn carriage and everything. And it was an extremely moving and touching day. And I was kind of blown away that my mother, who was an officer in the Navy in 1950, still got treated with that much respect after she had passed. But a shout out to all of our troops, whether they have served and been discharged, whether they're serving now, whether they're in reserves, waiting for the call. My hat's off to all of you.
Sure. Why don't you show the little casing there?
No, you know, that could lead to trouble. You know, people will be thinking that,
I thought that's quite a memento.
No, anyway, they did allow us to keep the shell casings from the 21-gun salute, so we passed them out to each of the members
and
of the
family. And I didn't know that. That's why I wanted to share that. All these little things, that's great. It's a great tradition. You know, whether you believe in it or not, I mean, people did serve, and we're able to talk on public access TV, mm-hmm. put our opinions out, right or wrong, and agree to disagree or even agree. So I appreciate it. Well, I got to do some infomercials. We got our usual unicycle. Notice how I pause for my guys to try to jump in here. They keep saying it. July 21st to 27th, we're going to try to get Dr. Trina Hess, who got us started on this, and maybe she'll come back for another show and tell us how she's doing in her outside course. Since you'll have to compete outside, maybe we'll head up there, as Devin heard last week or the week before. We may head up there, and it's with this group. It's the NAUCC. You can go to their website, North American Unicycling Convention and Championship. So it's quite an honor for it to be in this area. So check that out, folks. And then I'll let Chip, well, maybe I can handle this here.
I got this.
You want to speak about the Hainer's Angels?
Yeah, so coming up on June the 2nd, starting down at Heinz Field.
I'll hold it.
We'll be doing the March for Babies. My wife and I have a team.
Hainer's Angels.
Hainer's Angels. And if you're interested in contributing, we are accepting donations. You go to www.marchforbabies.org.
/?
Team Hainer Angels. You know, it's a worthy cause. It's to help, women with at-risk pregnancies and to help to bring more healthy babies into the world. And, you know, since my wife and I have suffered a number of losses, this cause has become very important to us. We've been doing it every year. The walk starts down at Heinz Field, and it actually takes you through the north side. You take a walk through PNC Park. You walk along the outside of the ball field and down through the north side, across the 10th Street Bridge, maybe, or one of the bridges, and you end up back at PNC Park. And it's a really worthy cause. It's a good time. You know, if you register and collect $50 in donations, they give you a free ticket to the Pirate game that day. So, you know,
it's a bonus.
It's a bonus, but it's a good cause, and it's a well organized event, and the money goes to where it's supposed to. So,
what day is that on again?
June 2nd. It's a Sunday.
And now here's a date for you guys to remember. The Penguin game is going to be on Friday night. The Western Pennsylvania Police Benevolent Foundation, they help the fallen officers' families. They need 40 more volunteers at the Penguin game. They have 7 different kiosks. There's a 50-50 raffle, which at a playoff game, I'm not sure of the prices yet. Drew didn't get back to me. He's in between being in town and out of town. But you can get a hold of them. Go to their site, WPPBF.org, and they need volunteers. You can email at avolchko@wppbf.org, and that way you can go there, sell the tickets, and if it's me and I make it there, I'm going to be peeking at the Penguin game a little bit while we're doing that. But it is for a great cause, because here's another great group. They're all volunteers, they're all officers. 100% of all money collected goes to the families of the fallen officers. So you can't beat that, guys. And they're really a great organization. And we've
contributed to the to their cause before, and we've touted their
events.
Yeah, their events and their
benefits
and their charitable fundraisers, because you know, this is another unappreciated line of endeavor. The officers, and they put their lives at risk every day to make our lives a little safer. So,
right, you know, and it's a shame.
It's well worth the money to invest.
But think about being a volunteer, all you guys and girls out there watching it. How cool will that be to go down there with a packed house? You got a Penguin game, they're going to close out and win the this series here and move on. So I may
gotta
be there myself.
Got to handle business tomorrow.
We'll talk about that. Part of my thing is, you guys stole my thunder with the Penguins. I already talked about the Pirates yesterday. Chip, I was at the game Friday night.
Saw
the great air. I tried to send a picture from my dumb phone to you because we were out in left field. And guess what? Nothing would go out. My daughter even had her... you know, Android, we couldn't send any pictures out.
Yeah.
My son was trying to, I said, we got to send one to Chip because he's always doing it. Here he sent me another one and I showed my daughter and she goes, you couldn't send it on your phone, but he sent you that nice picture.
You got to sit behind the plate. That's the key.
Well, we're out in left field enjoying a birthday and my son's birthday, and we got to see a great game.
Oh, you mean literally, not figuratively.
I was out in left field as I normally am. The seats were great and comfortable, like I said. Let's go, Bucks. That Kool-Aid is still being digested by me. It's not so sour right now,
Chip. We'll get into the Pirates a little later on the show. So
definitely.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely.
Now we'll go to the segment that I always like to revisit some of the comments because sometimes we're controversial, sometimes we don't agree. Tonight we're talking, you know, Vacoon, Marc-Andre Fleury. I was on the record as saying I like, you know, Marc-Andre. He's the main pitcher. And you got the relief pitcher filling in. So I've been wrong about Vacoon.
Well, you know, to speak to the points, I agree with Zach. And I also agree with Big Mike Butera, okay? And that doesn't mean that I disagree with either one of the two of them, but this is what I believe. You know, Thomas Vacoon has been playing phenomenal hockey. The Penguins have been playing excellent defense in front of him. They're playing better defense in front of him than they were playing in front of Marc-Andre, which, you know, helped to... get Marc-Andre
and he was a little shaky.
But to speak to Mike Butera's point, you know, I believe that the Penguins are going to win the Stanley Cup, that Marc-Andre Fleury will play an important part in that, and I do believe that the flower will blossom before the playoffs are
Whoa.
Over.
Hey, redemption.
There's your spring report here.
Mm-hmm. No, I mean, come on, Marc-Andre, he's been there, done that. Vacoon.
Oh, I didn't
Vacoon
give up on him.
Vacoon is 36 years old, too.
Vacoon is playing very well, even though... You know, he gave up that game-tying goal with less than 30 seconds left in game three. No, you know, but he probably played his best game of the playoffs in that game. He stopped 46 shots.
Oh, yeah.
That's very stout goaltending. You know what? When you get it into overtime, you know, you're rolling the dice there and anything can happen. And, you know, the Penguins played very seriously on Sunday. We'll go back to the Penguins. Solid defense, but
we're
trying
to revisit his Marc-Andre thing here.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll get that because we got a lot of Penguin talk. We're a little fired up about that.
This isn't the first time in the city where we've had a situation with goaltending in the playoffs.
No.
And it's not going to be the last time. So, but it helps when you have two. Because when we only had one, we were done.
Right.
So now that we actually have somebody that we can have, you know, so
we'll look at all the extra players.
Tip your hat to Ray Sherrill.
Ray Sherrill,
a genius picking up Tommy Vacoon.
Kudos to you, Ray. We appreciate it. Now we usually, I'll go to Sips Sports Bar. That's usually what we go to next. So tonight, if you're at Sips Sports Bar and you're not there yet, and you're watching it here. Tuesday night is Don Campiti's Pizza. 50 cents a slice. He's at Potomac Avenue. It's a classic there. You've heard me saying back in high school we had pizza there. It's still the same pizza, same great ingredients. I saw Don last night at our Sips Sports Bar show. He was smiling ear to ear. He loves the show. He's a fan of the show. He's watching it. Shout out to you tonight, Don. Hope they enjoy your pizza at Sips Sports Bar. Then Thursday, Jumbo Wings. Smoke and Jim and I were both there at one time. No, Brazil wasn't there. But China was there, and we had the wings, and they were great. Of course, I was there early. Smoking Jim was there late. And
fashionably.
You know, exactly. So you got to go there. And then Friday, Jumbo Fish Sandwich, $7.50 with coleslaw. Check out their Saturday nights about 8 or 9 o'clock. They always have some type of entertainment. And we had a great show there last night. A lot of great guests. We had Claudio Rosano, the coach of CMU. He filled in. Little Z. He was filling in there, too, except Big Mike D grabbed the main seat there for Smoking Jim.
Hey.
So we got him in there, and we had a great show there, great guest. Alicia was on there, one of our favorite models in the area, put on a great performance. Pittsburgh Force, Kathy was there, the owner of the team, Cat Ferrari, and she had two great players.
Great players.
Rookies.
We had
great interviews.
Yeah, we had great interviews, great time, great talent, but that, you know, greatness remains to be seen. We're going to go check it out.
Well, there's great
on
optimism.
Sunday, since I might be buying a piece of that team to turn them around, we'll go check it out on Sunday and see what's going on with Cat Ferrari and these Pittsburgh Force
football
team.
We'll have to see what little Z does there.
I'm
so
going to report it back.
You got to come out to Sip Sports Bar. We start up about 7:30. We're on a little late schedule this week. It was almost 10 to 8.
Are we going to do Monday night?
Monday. You can't come there on Memorial Day. We're having the holiday off, but we'll be back there the next week, and we'll be ready to roll, and we'll expect to see a nice crowd there like we've been getting there. Appreciate
it. Hi, Tina.
And, hey, thanks for Kelly at the bar. Great bartender. We always have our water. Our fries are there. And Dan, he's holding that cup for Smoking Jim. And Smoking Jim, when you watch that, hope you get better real soon with the vehicle. Can't wait to see what happens there. So we need you back on the road there, buddy. Hate to see you miss two shows in a row. That's a rarity, folks. That's like a blue moon. So, not a beer.
Hey, Smoking Jim, you call me up. I'll give you a ride after the show's over. I'll pick you up.
There you go. And now, in honor of Smoking Jim, fiction and fact from Smoking Jim's Almanac. If he doesn't call in, we're not going to do it. Okay, he didn't call in. And I know he's got Verizon 32. He's always telling me he's at somebody's place in Plum, Monroeville, all over the area. Well, now, one of my favorite segments is Chip's Trivia Time. What do you have here, Chip?
What do you have? A little thin on trivia this week, and I'm going to go back off of my memory because I did put out a post one day last week. I think it was might have been Wednesday or Thursday, which, depending on the day, but I know back in 1941, I believe it was last Wednesday or Thursday, one of the greatest records in baseball history was begun. Joe DiMaggio began his 56-game hitting streak, and that happened in the summer of 1941, and that is a record that will never be broken, the 56-game hitting streak. If you think about that, closest anybody has ever come, Pete Rose, Charlie Hustle, 44 games, but I just don't see it happening, not in this age of specialization with pitchers. You know, back in the day, a pitcher would start, he would pitch 9, 12, 15 innings or whatever. The guy's arm would get tired, and if he got you out the first three or four times, last time up and his arm's getting tired, you'd get a chance to get a hit against him. But, you know, now it seems like every pitcher you're facing is throwing mid-90s, and nobody ever pitches long enough for their arms to get tired. But, you know, we're in the midst of the Stanley Cup playoffs, and I've got a couple of useless bits of information regarding the Stanley Cup. The Stanley Cup itself, the trophy, is 2 feet and 11 inches tall, and it weighs 34.5 pounds. There are 2,200 different names engraved on the cup, and that includes players, coaches, and owners. There is one player who's got his name engraved on that cup more than any other, and Zach had the answer on this one last week, Andre the Rocket Richard of the Montreal Canadiens. And, you know, you look at the cup and you say, you know, every year it keeps it. Well, every 13 years they add another ring onto the cup to add the names for the teams that they get added on. So, you know, that's my Stanley Cup trivia. It's a little weak this week, but, you know, I had a pretty big schedule. And yesterday I was scrambling all day, you know, down at D.C., and I was trying to get caught up today. So that's what I've got for trivia this week.
Well, plus, folks, he left in the morning to travel there, and then afterwards he drove back home. So just in itself, that's like a regular shift. 4 hours back, five in, whatever, because with traffic on the way out there. So thanks a lot, Chip. I appreciate it. Now we come to our newest segment, which is gaining some popularity. I had one person tell me about it. Big Mike, so it's starting to gain.
Well,
we got Big Mike's questions.
Before I go there, I wanted to. We talked about this before the show. The Joe DiMaggio streak is actually being broken in the year 2026 by it's in the Star Trek 9 something thing. Mm-hmm. I was telling you about. Saw that in the newspaper today. Yeah. And Joe DiMaggio, he was held hitless in the 57th game, but then he went on starting the very next game and hitting something like 22 more consecutive.
Well, you know, to start the streak out, he kind of started it kind of very nonchalantly. He only went 1-for-4 in the first game of the streak. But, you know, I still think that is the one record in baseball never going to be broken.
No. It's your roommate or something like that.
And I don't believe he made it out of the high 20s or low 30s. And Ichiro is amazing.
I think he was in the 30s because, I mean, I think a Sanchez for the Pirates made a run out of it or something, too.
Yeah, Ichiro, tell you what, he's probably one of the best modern-day hitters. And I bet had he not played as many years in Japan and had played here in the major leagues, that he would already have 3,000 hits, because I do believe in his first 10 years in the major, he averaged 200 hits a season, and that's phenomenal. I mean, because you think about, you know, you average 200 hits a season, it's going to take you 15 years to hit 3,000 hits. And 3,000 hits is a benchmark. That's like, you know, the ticket to Cooperstown. And, you know, are guys even playing that long anymore? You know, you really don't see that happening. So, you know, like, pitchers winning 300 games, batters getting 3,000 hits. I think these are things that are going to be very, very rare.
Absolutely.
Big Mike, your segment here.
Well, I'd like to do
it. Big Mike's questions coming up at you.
I'd like to do it, but now that I know he's so knowledgeable in the hockey stuff, I'm going to have to read it from the side so he's not looking over my shoulder here. But
he doesn't
need to do it anyway.
No, he's not.
Okay, what's the Z-Man? What's the tradition of the Detroit Red Wings fans during
An octopus on the ice.
Wrong. Octopi. They throw more than one octopus. It's octopi.
Okay. That's sure like, it is an like... octopuses.
Which was the name of a James Bond movie.
This is a family show. Okay. it is octopi. It's like the Three Stooges were ignoramuses. No, they were ignorami. Okay, so I'm going to give you the names of four hockey teams that have a bit of a tradition, only two of which are NHL teams. There's two collegiate teams, Harvard and Cornell. But in order to do their thing with the octopi, one team's fans throws out rubber rats, another one throws out chicken, another one throws out fish, and another one has had waffles thrown on the ice. So that would be Toronto, Cornell, Harvard, and the Florida Panthers, I think.
The Panthers throw the rats, because I know that from when Brasso.
He's not
what
looking
a guy,
at
what
shame.
A guy.
He knows that from when Tommy Vokoun used to play next.
Yeah.
Okay.
For the Florida
good,
Panthers.
Good, good. Keep going. Okay, we got chicken, fish, and waffles.
What's the teams?
Yep, the teams are the Harvard teams, or Harvard, Cornell, and Ithaca, Harvard and Cambridge. And the Maple Leafs. Waffles, fish, chicken.
Wow.
And if you watch my eyes, I probably gave it away.
I'm going to go Maple Leafs with the fish.
Well, that would be one right and one wrong.
I like Maple Leafs with waffles.
That's right on.
That's
because
what I like.
Because maple syrup.
Yeah,
thanks.
However, it really has nothing to do with it. No, this is anybody's guess here. But that has
you
nothing
put
to
it right on little Z and he's manning up. What are you doing there trying to throw it off of him?
It has nothing to do with
if he hits you, it's not our fault.
No, I read a promo for the guy. What do you want, okay? The Cornell and the Harvard teams have chicken or fish?
Yes.
Okay. The Cornell fans throw out fish. Why? I have no clue. And the Harvard fans throw out frozen chickens.
Frozen chickens.
Yeah. The interesting thing about the waffles and the Toronto Maple Leafs was during their run, well, they're still on that run since 1967 when they haven't won a cup.
Yeah.
There was a fan, and his name was Joe Robb. He wanted to protest the fact that, you know, when someone has a hat trick, they throw out hats and blah, blah, blah. So his protest was throwing out frozen waffles to kind of like let the team know that they're tanking or whatever. And that was his last time was in 2010, and he's been banned ever since.
So it actually has nothing to do with maple syrup in Canada.
He just came up with frozen waffles.
I just took a nice guess at it, and that's when the Penguins were born in 67,
correct,
so maybe that's the reason they haven't
won
yet.
Penguins came in that year. Yep. I believe the Minnesota North Stars did as well.
Spot,
as the
original
Blue.
Six and then the baby six.
Yep. St. Louis Blues were one of them.
Yep. Los Angeles Kings, the San Francisco Seals, the Minnesota North Stars.
Have you been studying on your birthday? Did you get a book on
no,
hockey
but I,
trivia?
What I meant to thank you for is that nice thing. I just don't know how to respond, you know. I read... this thing's, you know, the face. I can read things coming in. I just can't get stuff going out.
You know what? I send a lot of stuff out. Some people just enjoy reading it. You don't have to reply to everything. Chip's one of the few that can like everything that applies there when he's on.
What happens? So. Did you ever go on his or Chip's, what do you call that?
Facebook?
Yeah.
Newsfeed.
I just keep going down the line and looking at all the people you're hooked up with. And I came across... It wasn't Joe DiMaggio or Babe Ruth, but
Ernie Banks.
We're
personal friends, buddy.
Well, I have some personal friends I like to talk about.
I got 902 of my closest friends on FB. So
awesome,
and it's all in the past year.
Get out!
I'm serious. And you can find me on LinkedIn too if you want to talk some business there too. It's a great way to try to do some business. I don't tell all my personal business, you know. But it's a nice way to meet people and put the word out in a nice way.
If you look at Smoking Jim's, yeah, he meets people.
He's got a lot of people.
You want to look at
Smoking Jim, he has some of the prettiest women in the world.
He's the ambassador for the University of Gateway. He's the ambassador for the University of Gateway and main recruiter.
Yeah, and
that's where he's at right now. He's recruiting in Altoona.
He's probably watching some film. He's not even watching the show right now. He's scouting for next year. Believe me.
I was hoping he was going to be here tonight because I wanted to ask him to explain.
Tell him to call in. What number is that?
See, that's a problem. He doesn't know what the number is.
He doesn't.
Smoke. It's 412, like 412, you know, and then the 831. What is it?
3304.
I wanted to ask you this. Did you say a moment ago that they watch? Does SIPS have this on live?
They have Dish, so they can't watch it. Oh. But I said if anybody's here watching it, go to SIPS on your way home. What? Go up to SIPS Sports Bar and get some pizza. Campiti's Pizza.
I'm telling you what about Campiti's Pizza. They got the best pepperoni in the city. He gets it delivered from Chicago daily. I'm telling you, it's good stuff.
And on that happy note, we usually talk some boxing now just to break it up. And our resident boxing expert has his own gym. He does all kind of training and everything else. And I, you know, just want to have little Z talk a little bit about boxing in the area. Anything else happening with boxing right now or anything you want to report?
Well, to anybody watching, if you're looking for somewhere to train or you're looking for a trainer, give us a call, 412-583-5047. That's 412-583-5047. We're licensed to train amateur boxers. I myself am licensed to train amateur boxers. So if you're looking for your opportunity, give me a call and we'll put your son, you know, to work. We'll put him to good use. Right now, we're working on some fights coming up for the Pittsburgh Kid, Pulse Battlefora, Lightning Rod Salka. So we're just in the process of finalizing these deals.
Well, sure. You got to work things out.
How about Sammy Vasquez? He got any fights coming in the near future?
Yeah, Sammy Vasquez actually has a fight coming up in the next week. So
is it in the local area?
Yeah, it's local.
We haven't heard anything about it. Why didn't they get a hold of us? What's going on there? Well, I don't want to cause too much controversy.
If the Prophet Hainer not brought it up, I probably wouldn't have mentioned anything about Team Vasquez because they're not cutting me any checks or anything like that or giving me any royalties. So it's not really my job to promote. You know, I'm not the fighter.
I got you.
I'm not the promotions for that event.
They've been on our show, and they're welcome to come back
anytime. I've passed the invitation out at the last fight down at IUP. I ran into Sammy Sr. down in Paul's fight down in West Virginia. So the door has been open. So
well, thank you. I appreciate you spreading the word
here. It's not due to any lack
of effort. Since you're our regular guest host, who's now filling in 2 weeks in a row here, this is another BPTV first. You know that little Z.
And since we're in Bethel Park, most of the time we spend time talking about other businesses and other areas and stuff like that. But I got a couple businesses in Bethel Park that I'm in good contact with. And one is Roberti's Auto Body in the Industrial Plaza in Bethel Park.
Right.
See Frank Roberti, tell him Zach Brenner sent you, and he'll take care of you, that's for sure.
Anybody in Bethel, they know about him already, little Z. You might be a step or two behind, but thanks for announcing it. We are about promoting Bethel Park.
And Frank's like a grandfather to me, so hey, Frank, keep up the hard work. He's 67 years old. And still going strong at Auto Body over there in Industrial Boulevard.
Big Mike looks up to him already. That's what he's trying to do. That's why he's selling cars, wherever he's selling cars at. We'll bring that up at the end, maybe. Now let's go to Penguins. We've been itching to talk Penguins. I had to stop Chip a little bit there because this is what I wanted, the Penguins segment. We all have our opinions. 10 more wins. That's all they need, folks.
I want to correct you right there, Alan. What they've got is they need two more wins.
Correct.
Because they got to win two games before they can go on to win the next set of four. And they have to go at these in four-game chunks.
Hey, I don't play the game. I got faith.
Because you know what? The faith isn't going to get you a Stanley Cup. Nope. Let me tell you something. Hard work is. They've played very well the first three games of this series. They played much better so far in the first three games of this series than they did against the Islanders. I think the Islanders were the wake-up call they needed. But here's what they got to do. They got to come back to Pittsburgh up 3-1, okay? And then they put this series to an end on Friday night. You know, they can't give this team life. It's going to come back.
There's an interesting stat for you guys. In the last year, they didn't have 40 wins from the home team at all, total. This year you have 40 wins. Now, I'm a conspiracy guy. It was a short season. Now you had 40 home wins. That means you have to come back and play at home to get more chances to win at home. Study that, my hockey friends here, as a little bit of trivia here. But you already have 40 wins in the playoffs at home. Mm-hmm. So it's an interesting thing.
But,
and
know,
I'm a fan, and I understand. I'm a Chuck Knoll guy. One game at a time. But when you have the talent like this, I expect them to produce.
To speak to your point, okay, home wins are great. Think about how many Game 7s were lost right here in Pittsburgh. That's why we
got
to close this team out as quickly as possible.
And not so much that, too, though. But Boston is steamrolling New York Rangers right now. So if they wrap that up quick, we don't want to beat ourselves up here with Ottawa and go in, you know.
I think the surprise right now, the playoffs, is one of the original six. The Detroit Red Wings are up 2-1 on the Chicago Blackhawks.
That was a good game last night.
And everybody, you know, yeah. the Blackhawks won the President's Cup. Best team, best regular season record this year.
Right.
And they're down 2-1, and the Red Wings are surprisingly in it.
And I got to thank Big Mike D from Pittsburgh Sports Nation, because if you didn't fill in that seat last night, I wouldn't have got to watch that game at Safe Sports Bar, the Detroit Red Wings and Chicago Blackhawks. So I got to thank you, Mike D. And you don't eat dinner there anyways. I eat dinner there every time.
Tina
knows. Everybody knows. Dan knows.
They know that. So
and I needed my time to eat my meal.
And you did pretty good on
that.
I need
more than fries, too, ladies and gentlemen. So Smoking Jim lives off of French fries and chicken, not me.
Well, hey, that's how it goes. All right, we cover enough on Penguins, or you guys want to say anything else?
No, I think, I think they're headed in the right direction. I think they're focused.
All right, we're on the same team, same page. One game at a time, folks.
One game. No more of that 10-game talk. I played games. I played in big games all my life and been in big situations on a big stage, and you never look too far down the road.
Yeah, but here's where you guys and I disagree. I'm a fan. When I'm playing the game, I only think of the play that I'm playing. I go to the minutia of it that all I'm talking about is I got to beat that guy for a play. Or when I pitch, it's the next pitch. I don't even think like that game. It's what I'm doing in the moment. So I agree with you in general. But as a fan here, I know they're going to win it, and that's what I predicted. So I agree to disagree on that. You know, I got to throw that out once in a while. But you guys are right, because when you're playing, you better be focused, because how are you going to win it? Look what happened.
We would be up 3-0 if they focused for the full 60 minutes and didn't let that backdoor play
come
in with 23 seconds.
We talked about it last night.
That's the mental errors. You could have all the talent in the world. One little mental lapse, and boom. Now it's a 2-1 series.
And like Chip said, that's what we brought up last night, Chip, that you had Letang and Malkin there. Let two guys get right behind him. All they were doing is watching the puck, because they assumed
nobody thought that Alfredson had that kind of step, and that pass was on the money.
Well, the pass was a great pass.
And you know, and the thing is, at that point, Ottawa was a desperate team, and desperate people will take desperate measures, and that's, you know, it paid off for them.
I agree. All right, let's move on to the Buccos. That Kool-Aid is getting sweeter all the time. I'm telling you, it's unreal right now. For to have this many wins, the record that they have.
Tell you what the Pirates did this past year, and there was all the experts that bashed the Pirates because they didn't agree with the moves that were made over the course of the winter, and they kept the core of the team that collapsed last year. They kept that intact, you know, and I think it was really a smart move on Huntington's point. And they brought in some talented veterans that, you know, are not going to be people that we're going to count on to win a lot of games, but they're role players, and they have been filling in very well, like Brandon Inge. You know, bringing in Francisco Liriano.
Yeah.
You know, Russell Martin.
That's
we probably overpaid for Russell Martin, but he's been a key piece to our success. Last Monday
night.
They got
killed with base stealing last year.
Monday night.
He's leading the league with
Michael McHenry. Was catching against the Brewers. The Brewers stole six bases on him, okay? The next three nights against the Brewers, they put in Russell Martin. He threw out a runner in each game. They stopped running, you know? That's what kind of a difference that Russell Martin has. And Michael McHenry has been working very hard with the coaches.
Yeah, he threw a guy
ever
out.
Since. And you know, because Clint Hurdle said that, you know what, the performance that Michael McHenry had last Monday night is unacceptable. So, you know, they're making the changes they need to make. Now, you know, another point I want to speak to in reference to the Pirates, you know, and you know, I always heard everybody, the Pirates don't spend any money, so they're never going to win. And I think that's the biggest bunch of horse hockey that I've ever heard in my life.
Because what went wrong with them is their draft picks and their farm system was in the tank, and they weren't evaluating talent. They weren't drafting the right players, and they couldn't afford to sign some of the more key players. Scott Boras, and those agents were blacklisting them pretty much.
They rebuilt the farm system, and while we're stocked with talent, that moving forward, we're going to have talented players we're going to have to find places to play. But you look at that, for example, the teams that have spent hundreds of millions of dollars on free agents trying to buy a championship. And the two teams that I'm thinking about both reside in Los Angeles.
The Angels, for one.
The Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim and the Los Angeles Dodgers. And they're two of the teams that are in the cellar in each of their respective leagues, the American League and the National League. So much so that Don Mattingly is on his neck's on the chopping block. Don Mattingly, you know, otherwise known as Donnie Baseball, a Yankee great, should be a Hall of Famer if he isn't already. But, you know, here you've got $200 million in payroll, and they don't play well together. You know, you've got a team with the Pirates, you know, in 2011 and 2012, they're going through a learning process. They learned some very painful, hard lessons. And as a fan, it was painful to sit through 2011
and
2012.
Wouldn't you say, Chip, that it's the common fan, though, it's hard to be as optimistic as you are from afar. It's hard to be real optimistic with the organization and the things that go on. And I think that a lot of people are even underestimating the hometown kid, Neil Walker's contribution. You know,
we've brought it up on our show.
And you know what? And that's a really good point, Zach. And I understand, like, you know, you know, I go down to the games. I've got a season ticket package, and I go to the games, and slowly I'm starting to see the seats fill up. You know, the beginning part of the year there was a lot of empty seats. Last Saturday night when I was down there was still a fair amount of empty seats, but there was a few more. People are coming back, and if they continue to play ball the way they are, they're going to win back the fans, you know, but I understand people's apprehension because, you know, we've been to the altar how many times, and, you know, we're still...
Two. Are we going to be buyers at the trading deadline instead of sellers for once?
I would think, you know what, with what we've got in our farm system and what we've got in our roster right now, I'd let people come and make offers to me.
Would you do what Cheryl has done with the Penguins basically trade, you know?
No, I would not make a trade this year. If I was the general manager, I would not do that because they've got plenty of help at pitching coming up out of their minor league system. They've got Morton coming. They've got Cole coming. They've got Tyon coming. They've got Jeff Karstens coming up. So we're going to have help pitching. And we have got the veteran pieces on the bench. Like, you know, I know a lot of people don't like them. McDonald. He's a good late inning fill in defensively. Brandon Inge is great, and you know what? Right now, a lot of people have bad mouthed Barmas, the shortstop, and right. I say Barmas is a great defensive shortstop, weak in the stick. Okay, but you know they brought up Jordy Mercer to take the place of McDonald. Now Jordy Mercer. Barmas is signed through the end of this year, and then that's it.
Right.
They want Jordy Mercer to go down to AAA and play everyday shortstop because they are looking at him to potentially be the starting shortstop moving forward. Now, when I watch Barmas and I watch Jordy Mercer play, Jordy Mercer's got a better bat, okay? I've seen him, you know, hit a few home runs, but Barmas has been batting well lately. The drawback I have on Jordy Mercer is I don't think he has the range that Barmas does, okay? He's an adequate fielder. Barmas makes the routine, the spectacular plays look routine, and he makes all of the routine plays. You know, it seems like Jordy Mercer just is just, you know, a a hair off on some plays. The balls get by him that wouldn't get by Barmas. But I think Jordy Mercer could possibly be the shortstop of the future for the Pirates.
So you think Clint Hurdle is effective as a manager right now for the Pittsburgh Pirates?
Absolutely.
I think there's actually been an improvement because he was managing by his gut. And like I said, the last 2 years, I said it's great when his gut's working, but it hasn't always worked because the players didn't produce, just like, you know, in any sport. Well, and I think he has a lot of the tools to use. That's why I'm on the bandwagon early this year. I didn't get on it till late last year because I saw the few little sparks. And when they were up 16 games, that's where I was excited. Now I see that there's more cohesiveness on the team, and he doesn't have to pull as many, you know, little options except with the pitching.
Well, I'll tell you
starting pitching is so weak in general.
To speak to Clint Hurdle, the thing he's done, and I believe he's learned from some of his mistakes, and he still does make mistakes, but what I see out of the team itself, you know, you've got like Pedro Alvarez will crush a ball and hit a 500-foot home run, and the next night he's sitting on the bench. And here's what, you don't have anybody pouting. Everybody's accepting their roles. You know, they know they're going to play. They're going to get their chances, but they realize that, you know what, if I'm not playing tonight, my teammate, I have to root for him. I got to back him up, and he's going to pick up the stick. And they're playing very well.
Wasn't it funny that Rashard Mendenhall didn't get that memo last season for the Pittsburgh Steelers? Hence, he's no longer a Pittsburgh Steeler.
Oh, he got it. Then he forgot to show up. That's the other reason he's not there.
Rashard wasn't a team player. And if you go back and check the tape, folks, Rashard Mendenhall blew the Super Bowl for us. Because we were on the march, we were on the charge. The momentum swung. We were marching down the field. We were pounding the ball, and he fumbled.
There's little Z with a little fiction in fact from Little Z's almanac.
And smoking
Jim. Just
tossing
out, smoking.
And smoking Jim. I apologize for this, my friend. You refer to Bruce Arians as the genius, and he's going to find out that. He's not going to look so smart.
There's nothing genius.
Hey, since we're talking football.
We're going to hitch it up, Mendenhall.
Since you guys segued right into football, I wanted to bring up the Steeler OTA started. What do you guys think about it, you know, with having everybody come in, you know, and doing it? Is that a good thing or does it matter at all?
Well, me and Chip work outside, so you know what it feels like working outside. So I think it's a good thing to get those guys out there.
It's a good thing
to get
them.
Me too. I'm with you. I didn't say I was against.
Before we get to Latrobe. But. You know, I like to see what we got a little bit.
And here's the thing. They need to get acquainted with one another because they've, you know, they've revamped the team. And everybody's complained about, oh, geez. You know, they look at all the players that we got rid of. And Kevin Colbert said it very succinctly like this. Look, the people that we got rid of off an 8-8 team. So it's not like we dismantled
we
the team that was
14 to 0. You know, right. No, we didn't.
But
I agree.
You know, you think about James Harrison. You know, speak to the Steelers. You know, this guy... I do believe that he's taken one too many blows to the head because, you know, he was going to get paid $6.7 million for the Steelers. They asked him to take a 30% cut. Now, get your calculators out. Do the math, okay? That's somewhere around $4.5 to $4.6 million that he would have got staying with the Pittsburgh Steelers. So he signed with the Bengals. He's getting $2.25 million per year, okay? So that next year he's going to get half of what he would have paid to stay here. And then I hear this story about him. He spends between $400,000
to $500,000
on his body a year for acupuncture, massages, you know, hyperbaric chambers. Like, you know what, dude? You're going to be out of the NFL in about a year, and you're going to
be
broke.
Bankrupt because you spend all your money on these taboo things when you should just be drinking milk and lifting weights.
He let his pride get in his way of his common sense, and I don't understand how his agent let him sign
into it. I'll tell you why. It's about money. They thought that they could get more money elsewhere, and then guess what? Nobody called.
Because he's damaged.
I understand. I'm one of the guys that thinks
that
way.
But I would have rather kept Harrison and got rid of Woodley because I just love the drive in Harrison. I wish every player on the field on defense had the drive of that man. He's overcome a lot of obstacles. The man wasn't even drafted into the NFL.
He got cut five times.
Yeah, he was undrafted, and then he made one of the greatest plays, and I was there in Tampa Bay. He ran right down the sidelines. Larry Fitzgerald
was waving at
him. Trying his best to stop him. But, you know, you'll never forget things like that. But
no way.
There was moments like that we didn't have in the last Super Bowl.
And he was a great player.
And to speak to Lamar Woodley, I mean, here's a guy that's got all-world talent.
Hope he shows up.
And, you know, I mean, you know, he's constantly every year, it's a hamstring, and you know, and the way I was taught, hamstring injuries are usually an indicator of somebody that's not training as hard as they should. And I hope he gets serious. He's making a boatload of money, and he could be like the best linebacker in football if he just applies.
Maybe he'll come back like Tabata when he went to the minor leagues. Well, he come back in shape.
He'll be the best outside speed rushing linebacker on the team on the field. But as far as best linebacker, I mean, we got to hope that Lawrence Timmons seizes the moment and steps up, because he could be all world. Speaking of all world Lawrence Timmons.
I don't know about all world, but speak
to the Sailors, you know, I mean, how do you evaluate the OTAs? They're out there in shorts. They're not hitting each other because of a collective bargaining agreement. So you're really not going to get to see what they've got to offer until, July. Late July, early August, when they get into
the
latrobe.
But they're not mandatory, though. That's the thing. I don't think they're mandatory. So these rookies and these new guys coming and participating, that just shows you that their commitment level and that they're ready to step in and learn the playbook, learn the game, and get ready, for the latrobe.
Right, because most of them aren't signed.
But here's an interesting thought I had, and I was responded to something that somebody put out on the internet in regarding the Steelers, and they said, the question I believe was phrased, who do you feel that should be the Steelers' leaders this year? And my response back to this was, one of the problems with the Steelers is that everybody talks about leadership, but I don't see anybody willing to lead, And just because Ryan Clark will interview for a broadcasting job in front of every microphone or camera that he comes there doesn't mean that he's a leader. I mean, what I don't see out of that team right now is the guys that did just, this is how we do things.
You don't even necessarily have to be a vocal leader like Paul Mahler. Like, just be a leader on the field. Be a leader off the field. Just be a leader in how you conduct yourself. That's it. And the rest of it will,
Think of the Hall of Famer we talked about last week.
Joe Green.
Right there. That shows you what a leader is. We need some of that tradition. We were talking Chuck Noll earlier.
I mean,
you'll find it inside in the locker room when they start to play. Some of these guys will start to go to the forefront here. And the ones that are talking, they know who they are.
Well, we've talked about, and I know that Jim and you and other people have, bad-mouthed Hines Ward. But, Hines Ward was the leader of the wide receiver core. And I'm going to tell you what, that Young Money crew looked like a bunch of young idiots last year without the leadership, because they were acting like a bunch of fools. And
Mike Wallace, though. Mike Wallace was like cancer to those young guys, though, because what he did was he just undermined the whole integrity of what they were trying to do.
And where was the veteran leadership that jacked him up against the locker and told him, hey, look, get your head out of your butt and start playing football?
We had an 8-8 season.
Right, mm-hmm. And that's part of it. And I want to stand corrected. I'm not with smoking Jim on Hines Ward. I always liked the hard-nosed play. Anybody that didn't have any cartilage or ligaments that could play like that, was a super guy. Anybody that could fill in like he did, anybody that could knock guys out when he knew they were coming after him,
he practiced showed that the way he practiced played, hard. And he gave 100% every time, every down, every snap that he played, and never took a playoff.
That's why we have the problems that we have, because we don't have the James Harrisons playing as hard anymore. You don't have the Hines Wards playing as hard anymore. And you got these young kids that want to showboat and they want to dance after a 10-yard out for a first down. Yeah. Like, come on, get back in the huddle. We got 60, we
got
a lot
more. Part of this, guys, I think it reflects on the coaching staff, that you can have those kids everywhere, but maybe you have to sit them down like they do at times when they were talking about a one-trick pony, with Wallace for a while. They kept them under wraps a little bit. But then they ran off the reservation.
Hey, well, we'll see what Mike Wallace does down in Miami this year. We'll see, if he lives up to the contract.
Definitely.
I think one of the flaws with the coaching staff is that these are grown men and they're supposed to act like grown men. And if somebody is a grown man and they act like a grown man, I feel that he should be treated like a grown man. But when a grown man acts like a child, sometimes they need to be treated like children.
I have a question. How many grown men did you mention in there? Because I agree with you.
A lot of grown men.
You mentioned it, but here's my counterpoint to it. You have guys that are grown men, and they're playing a child's game, and they act childlike.
Not so much. The problem right now with the Steelers is that Tomlin is everybody's buddy. He's everybody's friend. He's like a player's coach.
But that's part of...
Cowher was a player's coach, but Cowher still towed that line where he wasn't afraid to grab you and get in your face.
And spit on you.
Yeah, and tell you that you messed up. No pun intended. Like, you effed up. Like,
right, This is public access TV. The opinions of Little Z here.
No, I mean every pass that every pass that Wallace short armed last year, he should have been sat on a bench. I mean, you know, every pass that he didn't try for, every route that he didn't like to play, he should have been sat
on
the bench.
Those alligator arms are
Why do you let that guy play? Because he's got game-breaking speed. The only way you teach him a lesson is let him watch the game.
Well, the way you taught him a lesson is they should have just shut him down from the beginning with his attitude, because it didn't help. It actually hurt us along the way.
No question.
Because he was taking plays off. He wasn't practicing hard.
Right.
His heart wasn't there. He didn't want to be here. So my thing is, even to my guys that work with me every day, if you don't want to be here, if there's somewhere else you'd rather be, then go to it.
And the other point that I think I brought up before is he was afraid a little bit too, because if he got injured,
he wouldn't have got paid.
That's part of it. When you're thinking about big money, if you get hurt, I don't care what insurance policy you have from Lloyd's of London to protect you, it's not going to be enough like you signed in Miami. So that's where you get the alligator arms. That's where maybe you don't stride out when a guy's going to kill you.
He's down there making stupid comments in Miami, talking about Tannenbaum is better than Ben and all this crap.
Tannehill, let me tell you something. You remember the weatherman with the newscaster from Channel
11?
Yeah,
nice guy.
Yeah, Tannehill,
right. Tannehill's a nice guy.
Tannehill, let me tell you something. He's going to hang Wallace out to dry. That dude's not going to make it today.
If they don't have an offensive line, he's going to be.
You folks, you saw over the years what Ben has done with no offensive line, nobody's essentially. Well, now we got Marquise Pouncey, a good friend of mine. What's up, Marquise? He holds it down in the center of that line, and he wasn't available to us in the Super Bowl against the Packers, and that hurt too.
Right.
So not making any excuses. That's one thing I don't do. I'm like Tomlin in that sense. We're all about accountability. We don't make excuses for why we didn't get to where
the next
we
man just, will stand up.
We get ready for the next season. We work hard in the offseason, and we come back, and hopefully we're 10-6, which is better than 8-8. That's what I'm predicting, a 10-6 season.
I'm with you, Little Z. I'm even leaning because of that easy schedule.
And I want to wax
11-5. I'm looking at 11-5. If we have a running back this year, folks, and a little bit of an offensive line where they get in the way, I think maybe we could be 11-5. That's how optimistic I am.
We could have had Lacy from Alabama.
Right.
And the Packers have him now. Watch him go on and have a great career.
Well, let's see what we develop here. I'm going to stay optimistic here.
Well, I just go on, previous things. And the National Championship
Lacy
game.
Too.
And he played for Alabama, and they're a powerhouse right now.
I understand. They're like a pro team.
Yes, they are.
They could beat half of the pro teams, I think.
That's always an argument for another day and another time and show. But
we'll do it on another show. We only got a few minutes left.
That's like saying Clayton Bears in single A. You know, everybody says that, you know, they'll get crushed if they play anybody else in double or anything like that. But, hey, you never know.
Until you try it.
Hey, and
look at TJ. Look at Thomas Jefferson. They're ruling triple A, and I honestly
believe that TJ ought to go up into quad A. And see.
Since we're talking some high school sports now. Yeah. So.
Sherpak, you should absorb Clayton and those athletes and bring them to TJ, and you'd have a powerhouse.
Imagine that. They'd be quad. They'd be the quad A. Hey, and a shout-out to everybody at the Whipple States and track and field. So good luck with all the local players and everybody out there.
My alma mater, the Whipple track up at Ballmer High School.
Yeah, there you go.
We got baseball, Whipple baseball, Still Valley still going strong in the playoffs right now. So shout-out to them.
There
it's election
go.
Day, so hello to all
and
the politicians.
And all of you guys and girls, you only got a minute or so to vote. I wanted to tell you early, but I didn't want you to leave the show. So now just walk down the street to the local place, get the last vote in Bethel Park or whatever community you're in. We appreciate you watching us all over from Plum to Upper St. Clair, Bethel, Munhall, Upper St. Hazelwood on Verizon 32.
Shout out to the Kamikaze Kid.
He's watching there throughout the city, Beachview, Brookline, Dormont, Upper St. Clair again, Bethel Park because we're in Bethel Park,
Homestead,
South Fayette,
Charlie
Homestead, Munhall, I think they're watching, Baldwin they're watching. But thanks for all that. Were you guys, anything going on? Big Mike, what's happening here? You haven't spoke for 15 minutes.
My head's spinning. It's like a coil.
Okay, Little Z, what do you got next?
Hold on.
Rick
and Loretti in Frankfurt, I wanted to tell you about the Z-Man's boxing place that says right here, no boxers are too big or too small to go train at his joint. So.
All right, you're going to get your shirt next time. Little Z, what do you have? We got to move.
It's done. It's already in the mail. It's coming.
All right, that's good. Chip. Closing remark, couple seconds here. We got a limit.
A couple of seconds, real quick. Bo Rat, look at me on the tube, huh?
Hey, and Chip Hainer knows all about Brunner Contracting, too.
Who puts the holes in donuts? That's what I want to know. It's an inside joke with his buddy there. That's another story from a long time ago. Hey, I want to thank BPTV and everybody watching our show. Thanks for the great feedback. Check us out at Sips Sports Bar in 2 weeks. We'll be there. Maybe you could even be on the show. If you have some questions, call here 412-831-3304. Like us on Pittsburgh Sportsline Facebook. We're trying to boost that up some more. Matt, thanks for the camera. Devin, thanks to the control room. Dave Cable, thanks for editing to make us look great. All of you have a nice Memorial Day. Be safe out there. Have a great week and weekend. Take care.